What's up, everyone? Welcome to Weekends with Anna Kasparian and Nando Vila. Nando, what's going on? How are you?
Feeling good, feeling fresh. Saturday morning. You know, the people in the East Coast, it's like 1 p.m. We're fresh, ready to go at 10 a.m. on a Saturday for you people. I'm feeling good.
Fresh is a strong word for me. I'm not feeling fresh at all. I'm so exhausted. It's been a crazy week. Yeah, I mean, just, you know, it's just like the daily grind and all the political news that comes along with it. But as you know, I'm always excited to do this show, and we have a massive, massive show planned for you guys today. We're going to have David Sirota on to talk a little bit about strategy and how progressives can, you know, get some concessions from corporate Democrats. What's the best way to go about that? Later in the show, I'll be talking about this looming eviction crisis that it doesn't even seem Congress plans to do anything real about, even in this, you know, relief bill back and forth. What they're negotiating doesn't even come close to preventing millions of Americans from being thrown out of their homes. And the tech industry facing a little bit of prosecution, which I'm actually pretty surprised about. That's what Nando will be talking about. Yeah.
Yeah, very, very surprising developments in tech. And I'm very excited to talk to David Sirota because I've long been a fan of his, even before he became kind of one of Bernie's top spokespeople. And I think most people maybe know him in that role, you know, from Twitter and just from being involved in the Bernie campaign. But Sirota has for a long, long, long time been one of this country's best investigative journalists. I mean, in terms of sheer production, I have no concept as to how he does it, like how he produces so many scoops. I mean, he was for years, he was like reporting on like, you know, crooked local courthouse schemes, you know, always following the money, like just scoop after scoop after scoop after scoop, in a way that I don't understand how he did it. So I'm very, very excited to talk to him because he's someone who has just been in the thick of it for decades and has
for sure
definitely learned a lot. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I've always been a huge, you know, admirer of his work. And yeah, you're right. I mean, every day I'm, of course, subscribe to his newsletter. So I get a story from him every day. And I'm like,
every single day.
Story? every day.
I don't understand. Who are these people? Yeah. Like who are his sources? I mean, he's got like 69 trillion deep throats. Wow. That was unintentional, but yeah.
So if you guys haven't already, sign up to get updates from the Daily Poster. That's the publication that he, you know, created after Bernie Sanders's primary run ended. And it's a fantastic source of daily investigative journalism. It's very valuable. But before we get to our Verso read today, I did want to just give everyone an update on something that, you know, we talked about on a previous show, Nando, and it was about the Amazon workers in Alabama who are attempting to unionize. There have been some positive updates on that front, so I wanted to just kind of update the audience about it. So the National Labor Relations Board has determined that a union pushing to represent Amazon workers in Alabama has enough support to hold an election. So, you know, it's a small update, but it's a good update. This is promising news. Of course, Amazon, I'm sure, is going to go into full disinformation mode to try to dissuade these workers from, you know, voting in favor to unionize. Amazon argued in its filings that the size of the proposed bargaining unit at the Alabama warehouse was more than 5,000 workers, making it difficult for the retail wholesale. It's amazing that they even try to do this argument. making it difficult for the retail, wholesale, and department store union to rally enough people to call for a vote. But the board determined that the union has demonstrated enough support, and so they're going to move forward. And so it's good news. We'll see how this all plays out. But much love to, you know, the workers in Alabama who are doing what they can to make this happen. They definitely deserve representation.
Yeah, I mean, it's that's a trick, right, is to just expand the size of the bargaining unit to make it much bigger than it actually is, because then they say, like, oh, look, they only got this this smaller percentage of the total bargaining unit to sign union cards, and therefore the union can't proceed. You know, it's funny, like, you know, this is a factory, and the worker, like, the Amazon's like own internal memos that they have access to from 2018, 2019 say that this factory, or I don't know if it's 2019, whatever the years, they have internal memos that show that this factory was, you know, 1500 workers, which is what the union drive is alleging. And in fact, Amazon's just like, no, there's 5,000 workers there. And it's like, what? You know, like, yeah. This is pretty easily verifiable. It's you know, hopefully it goes ahead. I mean, it's going to be a long drawn out fight, and it's going to be pretty vicious, but for whatever reason, it's, you know, the NLRB is kind of is playing ball. I mean, it's shocking, you know, given just the makeup so hopefully that, I mean, it's a small first step, but it could potentially be utterly transformative if a company mm-hmm. like Amazon was unionized. I mean, it's beyond things that we can even comprehend in this, with our small brains, in this current moment. So that's definitely some very welcome news.
So there's a good way to expand our small brains, and that's by reading more. And luckily our partner, they publish books. Expand your mind. Nando, tell us more about that.
Well, you know, if you join the Verso Book Club, Anna, you can get every new ebook that Verso publishes each month, as well as 1 to 3 books in the mail. All Verso Book Club members will also get 50% off all books for as long as you are a subscriber. To celebrate 50 years of radical publishing, each member tier is 50% off for your first 3 months. In December, Verso selected the best books published from this year, plus Comrades will get their brand new Comrade Canvas tote bag. You know, if you want to get your lady a good gift for the holidays, the Comrade tote bag is a good one. The Comrade tier is $20 a month, and if you join in December, you'll get Burn It Down, Feminist Manifestos for the Revolution, edited by Brian Faz. Long Live the Post Horn by Vigdis Hjorth, called the best post office novel ever written by the New York Times. Sinews of War and Trade, Shipping and Capitalism in the Arabian Peninsula by Laleh Khalili. And the Verso Book of Dissent, the revolutionary words from 3 millennia of rebellion and resistance, plus the Verso tote bag with Comrade in elongated black type on the front and the Verso logo on the back. Yeah, baby.
I love it. I love it. And I also love our Decode segment. So let's get right to it, Nando. Tell me about what's going on with Facebook and, you know, other tech companies that are being targeted by prosecutors.
Well, Anna, and the dear viewers at home, are you terrified of a future that is essentially a techno-feudal dystopia? Well, this Decode segment is for you. Overall, the pandemic has heightened trends that were existing before, and one of them was the growing power of big tech. I mean, just look at this chart. The tech stocks are surging. Apple became the first company ever valued at $2 trillion. Amazon, Microsoft, Alphabet, which is Google, and Facebook are not far behind. But something really big happened in the last week, and it hasn't gotten as much attention as I think it probably should.
This morning, federal and state authorities want to break up Facebook. The world's largest social media company hit with two major lawsuits, one by the Federal Trade Commission, the other by attorneys general in 46 states. Both lawsuits allege Facebook illegally crushed its competition, violating antitrust laws and creating a monopoly.
That's right. 46 state attorneys general, I've always wanted to say that, are alleging that Facebook is an illegal monopoly. And then just days later, 38 state attorneys general filed a similar lawsuit against the other dominant player in online advertising, Google.
The Department of Justice is suing Google today in what is the largest antitrust case against a tech company in more than 20 years. Our tech reporter Brian Fung has been following this. He's on the story this morning. I mean, this is the biggest really since Microsoft, right? What is the DOJ alleging here?
Yeah, it's the biggest antitrust case against a tech company in at least a generation here. What the DOJ is alleging is that Google controls 80% of the search market in the United States, and it's using its power to hurt rivals and damage competition.
The Trump administration and a coalition of red and blue states working together to take on Google and Facebook head on. I mean, this really kind of came out of nowhere. And it's hard to overstate just how big of a deal this is. I mean, the last time the government stepped in to break up a company was Microsoft back in the late 90s, early 2000s. And since then, there's been a ton of corporate consolidation in almost every sector, from banking to entertainment to beer. John Oliver did a whole segment about it, and I'm just going to use that clip because his team already did all the research for it.
Look, and airlines here are just the beginning. The rental car business is now 90% dominated by just three companies. The US beer industry is 70% controlled by just two companies. And online search engines are, of course, as we all know, dominated by one major player. That's right, say it with me, Bing. That's right, Bing, the best way to Google something. In fact, look. Full disclosure here, even our own parent company, Time Warner, is currently trying to merge with AT&T, which makes this story a little dangerous for us to do. Although, you know, that is presuming that AT&T executives managed to get their shitty service working long enough to see it. AT&T, it's the top telecom company around, alphabetically, and nothing else.
Thank you for that, John. And the Federal Trade Commission, which regulates mergers and acquisitions, have basically sat back and allowed all of this consolidation to happen without any pushback at all, until now. Now, we won't know what the outcome of these lawsuits will be for probably years, but it is a step in the right direction because the only entities that are large enough and powerful enough to confront these tech behemoths are national governments. I mean, we've seen how Amazon can just run roughshod over Seattle's local government when they tried to pass a very modest tax to fund more homeless shelters. And even a state as big as California was powerless to legislate Uber's employment model, culminating in the passage of Prop 22. And while the European Union has been pushing back on big tech for a few years now, the American government had basically done nothing up until now. And I want to focus on the case of Facebook first because I think it will be easy to understand for me and most people, given that it's products that most of us use all the time, every day. The key to understanding the government's case is Facebook's acquisition of Instagram and WhatsApp. Here's New York's State Attorney General, Letitia James, who is leading the onslaught.
The two most glaring examples of this unlawful scheme were Instagram and WhatsApp. Facebook bought Instagram for $1 billion in 2012, when the company did not even have a cent in revenue. And in 2014, Facebook paid the extravagant amount of $19 billion for WhatsApp, which was far more than industry experts and even Facebook itself valued the company.
Yeah, and, you know, back in 2010, when we were all blissfully surfing the web on our computers rather than our phones, a small little company called Instagram was founded in Silicon Valley. And as smartphone technology improved and we spent more and more time on the internet on our phones, Instagram's filters and cooler design and general newness meant it was catching fire, while Facebook's stodgy old desktop design made it feel like a thing of the past. The kids, as they say, were gramming. So Zuck just bought it. And as Letitia points out, that sent a powerful message.
They also sent a clear message to the industry. Don't step on Facebook's turf. Or as one industry executive put it, you will face the wrath of Mark.
Kale, I want to play that clip again for the people because I just want people to notice that it's just so savage that CNBC ran that press conference while side by side having a live graph of Facebook's stock price just collapsing by the second. Look, check it out.
They also sent a clear message to the industry. Don't step on Facebook's turf. Or as one industry executive put it, you will face the wrath of Mark.
Oh, baby, the good old stonks. So yeah, back in 2012, Facebook bought its most threatening rival, and all was well for Mark for a time, because the kids, they're fickle. The fads, they're changing all the time. And in 2013, there was a new player on the scene that all the teens were just raving about.
Turn now to the latest app that has caught fire with teens. It's called Snapchat. Yeah. You know, the appeal is, it says you can share a snapshot with friends without any risk of an embarrassing viral moment because the photo's programmed to vanish seconds after it's set. But is it encouraging kids to send inappropriate photos that actually won't disappear? ABC's Lindsay Davis has more on the controversy.
This message will self-destruct in 30 seconds.
It's technology right out of an Inspector Gadget episode. Teens everywhere believe they're sending their own self-destructing messages online with an app called Snapchat.
Yeah, in the immortal words of Yo Gotti, Snapchat me that. The Family Show. Can't go there. So the kids were leaving Facebook for Instagram, and then they were leaving Instagram and Facebook for Snapchat. So Zuck tried to do the thing that he had done just a year earlier, buy his competitor. Except Snapchat turned down his $3 billion offer, thinking, hey, we got the momentum. We can crush the Zuck. But they underestimated the wrath of Mark and his dominant position in the marketplace, because he owned Facebook and Instagram. He had way more users than Snapchat. And in a way, that's part of the appeal of a social media platform. The more people that are on it, the more social pressure there is to join it. And Snapchat had this cool new thing where you could send your nude and it would immediately disappear. So if Zuck couldn't buy them, he just copied the technology in order to crush them when they launched Instagram Stories. And apparently, Facebook executives were pretty open about this.
Mike, you broke this story overnight, and you quoted Kevin Systrom as saying other companies deserve all the credit on this. That's not something you hear Facebook executives say very often.
I think it was kind of hard for Instagram and Kevin to really deny that Snapchat pioneered the format here, you know.
So Facebook either buys its rivals or uses its market size to crush its rivals. And to me, it seems a pretty open and shut antitrust case. Facebook is a monopoly. And for its part, sorry, I just knocked my computer. For its part, Google is also an open and shut monopoly. I mean, seriously, does anyone use any other search engine? And the question is, why should I care? I mean, boo-hoo, some tech assholes are getting screwed by Zuckerberg. This is totally unrelated to me. Well, for one thing, the internet has become a sort of virtual reality for mankind, and having a handful of private tech companies control that space is just bad in a lot of ways. But concretely, for starters, Facebook and Google's dominance in the online ad market has essentially killed journalism. I mean, before, it used to be that websites and publishers could control their own ad sales, and it was never a great model, but it did lead to a bunch of sustainable news organizations. Remember, when there used to be a bunch of websites that you could just read and all had their own little delightful tone and focus? Well, they're all gone because Facebook and Google have essentially hoovered up all of the advertising money in recent years. As more and more of our online time migrated away from computers and onto our phones, our time spent has basically been within apps on our phone rather than through a browser. This means that the control of the advertising went to the app, i.e. Facebook, instead of the publisher, i.e. your favorite website or newspaper. And that means that Facebook and Google just swallowed up all of those ad dollars. And this has basically killed local reporting and investigative journalism, even in pretty big cities. For example, Pittsburgh, with a metro population of about 2.3 million people, does not have a daily newspaper. And while I think that the effect of social media-driven fake news is somewhat overblown in the US, I mean, I still think that the problems with the way America gets its news predate social media, and indeed, the biggest cancer in the American news ecosystem is, in my opinion, still television news, both local news stations that are essentially PR operations for police departments, and cable news, which just turns our brains into mush. And of course, who could forget the most consequential bit of fake news in my lifetime? That time that the New York Times said Saddam Hussein had weapons of mass destruction. But it is hard to ignore certain realities. I mean, there's a Twitter account, for example, that automatically posts Facebook's top 10 most shared posts of the day, and every single day it looks a lot like this. And this problem has had real effects, for example, outside of our borders. For example, fake news delivered through WhatsApp, which is owned by Facebook, was key in the rise of Jair Bolsonaro in Brazil. Here's Glenn Greenwald tweeting, pretty fascinating story, scandal involving Brazil's election. Bolsonaro has benefited from a tsunami of fake news spread en masse on WhatsApp, making mass media irrelevant. It was revealed today that corporations have paid millions for this. which is illegal in several ways. While the West obsesses on the spread of disinformation via Facebook and Twitter posts, Brazil is showing that WhatsApp, which is a huge in Brazil, but lots of other places, can be more powerful, as it seems to be personal messages from friends and is distributed by the millions. But beyond the threat to journalism that these platforms pose, there is something even more fundamental, and that is that they are turning our every social interaction, our friendships, our relationships, our families, into opportunities for profit. And the effects of this are predictably very, very bad. In The Guardian, last week's weekend's guest, Richard Seymour, writes, quote, social media addiction is rarely understood in this extreme light. Nonetheless, users often describe it wrecking their careers and relationships. The complaints are almost always the same. Users end up constantly distracted, unproductive, anxious, needy, and depressed, yet are also curiously susceptible to advertising. Patrick Garrett wrote of his social media addiction causing a desperate, hollow pressure of waste in his working life as a journalist. Social media addiction has been linked repeatedly to increased depression. Interaction with the platforms correlates with a major decline in mental health, while increased screen time or time on device may be contributing to a recent surge in teen suicides. Facebook's own guileful way of presenting the issue was to claim that while passive consumption of social media content could pose mental health risks, more engagement could improve well-being. This claim, while not supported by the research, would mean more profitable data for the site. Ah, isn't that funny? And we can all recognize this behavior, even if we are not ourselves in a full-blown mental health crisis. We can see echoes of that in our own lives. We may know people who have been lost to Facebook insanity or relationships that were destroyed by it. So now, the first few years of the Biden administration will be shaped by this landmark antitrust case. It will be interesting to see just how the politics of this will play out. I mean, on the one hand, there is a growing political consensus, not just amongst the population, but amongst politicians themselves, that we need to do something about the power of tech. But on the other hand, the Biden administration is quietly stuffing his transition team with a bunch of Facebook and Google people. So we'll see how that plays out. But while I applaud this move by the brave attorneys general, it is true that, not to sound too much like Hillary Clinton, breaking up the Facebook into its constituent parts won't end racism. No, I'm kidding. But breaking up Facebook into its parts is just a first step. And zooming out a bit, it is true that things like social media and especially search engines are probably natural monopolies, meaning that they don't necessarily work better when there are a bunch of smaller firms competing. Think of something like a subway system. It used to be that the subways in New York were run by private companies, competing with each other rather than coordinating with each other. And as you can expect, that was absolute chaos. A subway system needs to be that, a system, so that you can coordinate schedules, which routes need more or fewer trains, etc. There needs to be a single entity controlling all of that, which is why it's something that needs to be publicly administered for the benefit of all, rather than given to a private capitalist so that he can enrich himself. Social media and search are, in a way, similar. The search engine simply works better when there is one giant one receiving more inputs so it can better inform the results it gives to you. Ditto with social media. One of the points of social media is that everyone is on it. So if we're going to have things like search or social media, our goal should not be simply to limit their power, although that is a critical first step. Beyond antitrust, we should build towards a future in which these services are democratized. Last week on this show, Richard Seymour suggested that in the UK, the BBC could launch its own publicly owned social media. In the context of the US, the best example we have is probably the US Postal Service. I mean, the mail is a natural monopoly, and the Postal Service connects all of us in this country, is publicly owned, provides good unionized jobs to its workers, and critically protects our privacy in a very meaningful way. When we send a letter, we are quite confident that the post is not going to try to get information out of it for profit. And Yanis Varoufakis, the former Greek finance minister, has put together proposals for how we can democratize these firms. He writes, even Google's fiercest critics use its technology to research their fiery tirades against it, or more mundanely, to find their way around a foreign city. Let's be honest, life without Google would be awfully more tedious in a variety of important ways. But that is not a good reason to leave Google and the other tech giants alone. On the contrary, the nature and importance of their contribution make it imperative that they be placed under democratic control, and not just because of the well-appreciated need to protect individual privacy. This is true. I mean, we don't want to go back to a world pre-search engine. Even if that were possible, the cat is just out of the bag. And then he gets into what needs to be done. Google cannot credibly argue that the capital generating its profit stream was produced entirely privately. every time you use Google's search engine to look up a phrase, concept, or product, or visit a place via Google Maps, you enrich Google's capital. And while the servers and software design, for example, have been produced capitalistically, a large part of Google's capital is produced by almost everyone. Every user, in principle, has a legitimate claim to be a de facto shareholder. Of course, while a substantial part of big tech's capital is produced by the public, there is no sensible way to compute personal contributions, which make it impossible to calculate what an individual share might be. But this impossibility can be turned into a virtue by creating a public trust fund to which companies like Google transfer a percentage, say 10%, of their shares. Suddenly, every child has a trust fund, with the accumulating dividends providing a universal basic income that grows in proportion to automation and in a manner that limits inequality and stabilizes the macroeconomy. We on the left have to be thinking about this kind of stuff. We cannot retreat from these debates, because if we leave it to the libs, we're just going to get Microsoft 2.0. And we have to place this fight against big tech in the context of the broader fight against capital. Antitrust is just a part of it. But things like the Amazon unionization fight, which we talked about earlier in Bessemer, Alabama, which is still ongoing, is the other critical part.
Yeah, I love that. That was probably the best in-depth coverage of that story. And to be honest with you, I didn't know what to really make of it. And not that, you know, I didn't know how I felt about the Justice Department prosecuting Google and Facebook, but I was just curious, you know, where the left really stood on this. And you made a really great point about how the end goal should be to nationalize these tech companies and, you know, not have it be a private company that still has a profit motive. And when these are, you know, platforms that are being used by people like us, for instance, in order to spread a certain message, well, that gives too much power to a private company to decide what the narrative gets to be, what type of content gets, you know, floated to the top, what kind of content gets buried. And there's a very real reason why you see right-wingers constantly trending on most of these websites. It's because they know how the algorithm works. Their pro-corporate message, their pro-tax cut message aligns perfectly with these you know, various platforms. And so if you're doing content that's highly critical of, let's say, Facebook and its practices in selling data, is that content going to do well on Facebook? Probably not. I mean, I'm not stupid enough to think that they don't, you know, game the algorithm to their advantage when it comes to certain content. And that's a problem. And I love the that you mentioned what this has done to local news, but also to, you know, national news, people who got their start putting out digital content, right? People who are part of this new media revolution. Every year, the rules change. And I feel like every year you find yourself trying to figure out what this opaque algorithm is. And even when you do you really want to cater to a private company's algorithm when you're covering news, which comes along with, I believe, an incredibly giant responsibility to inform people about what's really going on in the country, in the world. So it's been really difficult to survive on these platforms. It's been incredibly difficult to be able to cover the stories that you know you want to cover and you will cover, but you know you're going to take a hit because the algorithm's going to work against you. And then one final point I just wanted to make about just like the divisiveness of the content that you see go viral on these platforms. There's a reason for that. You know, Mark Zuckerberg, it reminds me a lot of what Nixon did when it came to this study that he had commissioned on the war on drugs, right? He commissions this study, and it's called the Schaefer Report. Schaefer Report finds that marijuana legalization is not going to be a public health concern. It's not going to cause, you know, any of the damage that conservative lawmakers felt that it would at the time. And so Nixon takes it and is like, no, ripping it up, throwing it away, right? And Zuckerberg did the same thing when he commissioned a study within his own company to see what kind of impact some of the content on the platform was having. And the study found that, oh, actually, look, this it increases engagement. However, this divisive content, which increases engagement, is actually leading to a lot of division, a lot of, you know, political issues, all of that. And he just ripped it up. Don't care. Just going to move forward because we want the engagement. And more engagement means we can harvest more private data, which they then turn around and sell to third parties. I mean, we've talked about this on the show so many times. So I think this is a good first step. I think your analysis on this is right. And I think the ultimate goal should be to nationalize these companies rather than have a private, have like a CEO like Mark Zuckerberg decide, you know, what can and can't be held on these various platforms or on his platform. And then finally, Face the Wrath of Mark, that video.
So good.
I love it. She's I love it so much.
I love her.
She is the best. But you know what I think about? I immediately think about like his face and his haircut. And I'm just like, man.
we can't be led by that guy.
How much power that guy has. I know. Yeah. It's amazing.
That guy can't be like our dictator. Like, seriously, he's too ugly. I'm sorry. We can't allow that. I mean, what's maddening about a lot of these debates is that because they sort of get filtered through the partisan lens in which everything gets filtered in the United States. It's especially when it comes to tech platforms, regulation of what gets published on it or not. On the one hand, it is true that we don't want to give Mark Zuckerberg the power to just decide what is fake news and what is real news. I mean, you can see how that's a problem. I mean, just this week, there was a case of Instagram suppressing any content that criticized Biden for his support of the crime bill. Like, it was really insane. You know, like, this is like a pretty conventional wisdom at this point that Biden was like a big part of the 1994 crime bill. But because like some fact checker in something like claimed that it didn't exactly cause mass incarceration or whatever, like some sort of little small insane fact checking detail, which is a debate you and I have had in the past about the role of fact checkers, that they basically were taking down like people who were sharing that on Instagram. And it's like that's crazy. We can't allow that. Yeah. On the other hand, you also like, you look at just those Facebook top 10s every day and it's like, yeah, Dan Bongino, Ben Shapiro, Daily Wire, you know, like every single day. And if you're some kid and you start like going down a YouTube rabbit hole about like the Federal Reserve or something, like you might start off in the right place, but then like just the recommendation algorithm will just start taking you down a deeper and deeper insane rabbit hole, and like something needs to be done about that as well. So, but because it's like filtered in like the sort of liberal conservative partisanship, the debate is maddening because the only real role is democratization. The only real thing to do is democratization, that we should have a say in how these things are regulated, letting. So that's like one aspect of it. I mean, and the other aspect is to recognize that things like Amazon and Google like provide a really good and necessary service at this point in our lives. Like Amazon does provide an excellent service for consumers. Like it makes it very easy to get things, you know. So the question is then what do we do about it? Like how do we democratize that for all? And that's the real debate we have to have. Like we're not going to go back to a world of how it used to be. You know, the goal is to harness technological progress for all, you know, to make it so that we all benefit from it rather than we're all just kind of slaves to it. That's the real kind of debate that should be happening. So things like this scheme that, you know, Varoufakis comes up with of like, you know, creating these kind of public ownership trust funds that kind of oversee these tech companies is an interesting way to look at it. It's one example. I mean, I'm sure there's many other schemes to do it, but the fundamental principle remains that it should just be owned by us for the benefit of us. I think that's how we have to reframe this debate. But again, this antitrust thing, it's remarkable. I mean, it's just, I did not expect this to happen. I mean, there's been kind of a lot of, you know, there's been a lot of organizing around it, you know, especially around like this kind of anti-monopoly movement that's happened, which I have some disagreements with kind of ideologically. But I think that on some level, we both kind of agree that there's just too much power in these people right now. I mean, like, just look at the stock, just look at their market cap. I mean, it's insane. I mean, it's like they dwarf the banks. They dwarf, you know, oil and gas companies. It's just their size. It's their sheer the sheer power of them is just overwhelming, you know, and we need to do something to at first just stop that, you know, stop that growth, and then we can maybe sort of catch our breath and decide what we do after it. But so yeah, it'll be interesting to see how it plays out, because I mean, the Trump administration kind of did a funny thing, right? I mean, they just did it on the way out and kind of left it to Biden, which is you know, fair enough, you know, like,
yeah. I mean,
because now that it's ongoing, like the it's going to be a really bad look if Biden is going to be like, oh, actually, we're just going to remove all these things, you know. I mean, he could just blame it all on Trump and the libs will probably go along with it. But I think that there is enough of a awareness from everyone that social media is, there's a problem with it. Like, maybe we can't articulate it. Maybe we don't know what, like, how to solve it. But we all agree that we don't like this current state of affairs. We don't like it. So yeah, it'll be interesting.
Yeah, I'm curious to see how it plays out. But, you know, the way that things are set up, it also gives you this illusion of choice as well, right? Because, you know, you might see a negative story about Facebook and how they're intentionally using divisive content in order to increase engagement, in order to harvest more of your data, to sell to third parties without you even really realizing it. But what are you going to do, right? Okay, well, I want to keep in touch with my friends. I'm going to go to Instagram. You know, so I think that this, again, I think your analysis is spot on. I think you're right about what the end goal should be. But it's really difficult also to regulate these tech companies when they're honestly a bunch of different businesses in one, right? Is Facebook an advertising firm? Is Facebook, is it considered a news site? You know what I'm saying? It's like so many different things in one. And the sheer size of it and the versatility of that platform makes it incredibly difficult to really regulate it. And one of the other issues is that you have people in Congress who literally don't know how technology works. Yeah. Like, they don't know how these platforms work. They don't know what the practices are. And then you watch the congressional hearings where they're asking questions to, you know, the Google CEO, Mark Zuckerberg, whoever they're, you know, questioning at that time. And it's just embarrassing because they're not equipped with the knowledge necessary to really understand the weight of the issue.
Yeah, I mean, and I didn't even get into it just because for the sake of time, but the tax avoidance that these companies are doing is just absolutely obscene. You know, that they how they hide profits, how they use kind of tax havens and things like that to just pay basically no taxes on. Like, I mean, there's so many problems with their sheer size and power that it's almost too much to list. And I just needed to save time essentially. But yeah, I mean, again, we'll see. It's kind of, I didn't expect to see this happening, but it's happening. So let's go along for the ride.
Well, one other thing that's happening is evictions, even during this pandemic. And it's really gotten no attention, especially as congressional lawmakers continue to negotiate a relief package. Where they stand with the negotiations is shameful in a number of different ways. But when it comes to the issue of evictions, it's particularly bad. So let's talk a little bit about that. So there's a looming eviction crisis, and based how relief package negotiations are taking place among congressional lawmakers, it doesn't seem like they plan on doing much about it. Now, the CDC's eviction moratorium will expire on December 31st, which will lead to an explosion of Americans being forced out of their homes and onto the streets. And Congress is having a discussion about maybe we should extend this moratorium, but even that's not enough. So just to give you a sense of the weight of this issue, 6.7 million adults are likely to face eviction or foreclosure in the next 2 months. And you see actual instances of people being evicted even now during this so-called moratorium, when people are supposed to be housed in order to prevent the spread of the coronavirus. But again, just let me reiterate, that moratorium isn't enough. Here's what the scene looked like in Brooklyn on December 11th, when a tenant activist tried to block the NYPD from evicting a family from their home. Take a look. Just- And it didn't stop there. In fact, just last night, there was yet another protest, and New York State Assembly member Desmond Meeks was arrested for being there to witness what was going on. He was filming it, documenting it. The cops were there to try to evict a mother and her children, a single mother and her children. And of course, the weather is pretty cold and awful in New York right now. And here's what happened when cops confronted Meeks.
This is what we see. This is an eviction of RPD about to put a single mother and her children out on the streets. This is Assembly Member Damon Meeks. I'm under arrest for coming out here and filming what's going on. Okay. I'm under arrest for what? I need my phone. No, you're breaking my glasses. You're breaking my glasses. I'm just here as a witness. I'm here witnessing what's going on. I just came here.
Hand behind your back.
Okay.
Okay.
Don't resist. I'm not resisting you, my name.
How are people getting evicted right now, when there is a moratorium and when there are as many as 3,500 people dying every day from coronavirus? This pandemic is worse today than it was in the beginning of the pandemic. And in the beginning of the pandemic, I mean, at least there was some willingness for our lawmakers to take it seriously, to protect people, to ensure that people were housed, to ensure that there was something being done to provide some relief through robust unemployment benefits, through a direct check to Americans. But that's not the case right now, clearly. And all we keep hearing about is that looming December 31st date. But again, Congress hasn't done enough. The CDC hasn't done enough. And when it comes to the more recent moratorium that was implemented by the CDC, the problem was that it was implemented and written in such a vague way that some states decided to interpret it in, let's just say, a way that isn't so generous to people in need. Take a look.
It's important to realize that the federal moratorium that's due to end wasn't good enough to begin with. It didn't come until September, and that was months after people in places like Kansas City had been evicted and forced to the streets in the middle of a global pandemic. The CDC moratorium only covers one type of eviction, and those are evictions for non-payment of rent. It leaves a lot open to local interpretation, and it puts the burden on tenants to apply for that protection. So the CDC moratorium was not good enough, but the CDC moratorium allowed to expire at the end of the month leaves hundreds of thousands, millions of families vulnerable to eviction within the first 20 days of the next year.
And she's absolutely right. I mean, in some places in this country, you even have federal judges who are hearing eviction cases and siding with landlords. One perfect example is Judge Patricia Kinsey from Florida, who has decided to consistently side with landlords. She sided with a lawyer for a tenant named Steve Crowley. She sided with a lawyer for tenant Steve Crowley's landlord, a big Canadian company that owns 19,000 rental units in North America, who'd argued that the CDC order was unconstitutional. In fact, she thought that this was horrible when it comes to private property. Agreeing with the landlord's lawyer, Kinsey ruled that the CDC moratorium represented an unlawful taking by the U.S. government of landlords' private property rental income. Oh no, I mean, we can't mess with private property. But to be sure, there is an issue with mom and pop landlords who literally rely on their rental, rental property in order to pay their own bills. And to be quite honest with you, we haven't really seen much of an effort by Congress to handle that situation either. And look, even when the pandemic was, finally taken seriously and people were housed, because it was considered an important public health measure, the system still will value profits over human lives. So for instance, take a look at this tweet by Mike Baker, where he mentions that there's been another record. More than 250,000 new coronavirus infections were identified in the United States today. This was a tweet that he put out there on December 18th. Over the past month, about 5.9 million new infections have been identified. That's one out of every 56 people in the nation. Now, I give you that statistic because it's important to understand how this virus is just tearing through the country. It continues to be a gigantic public health concern. Yet people are being unhoused already, even before the moratorium is lifted, and Congress has failed, as of now, as we do this story, has failed to come up with a robust relief package that really addresses these issues. But even a robust, foolproof moratorium isn't enough. And I want to make the case for that, because all it really does is provide a temporary bandage on something that was a gushing wound even before the pandemic. Unaffordable housing, homelessness, these issues existed before coronavirus started to tear through the country. And remember, the eviction moratorium isn't the same as rent cancellation or mortgage cancellation. All it does is kick the can down the road, and Americans are still going to owe thousands of dollars in back rent. So for Americans who did find some protection under the CDC's moratorium, understand that once it eventually expires, and we know it eventually will, their landlords will try to evict them if they are unable to pay that back rent. The portion of tenants owing back rent has roughly tripled during the pandemic, federal census surveys show. The most recent survey tracking the pandemic's impact on households identified an estimated 18% of households behind on rent payments. So what do you guys think that looks like? How bad is the problem? What does the average renter own as soon as these moratoriums are lifted? Well, the Federal Reserve Bank of Philadelphia says renter households experiencing job loss because of COVID-19 currently at this moment owe an estimated $7.2 billion in unpaid rent, or $5,400 each. But don't expect the appropriate response from our congressional lawmakers, like, for instance, Republican Senator Ron Johnson, who literally had the balls to stand up and give this ridiculous speech this week.
When I came to the Senate, we were a little over $14 trillion. Our GDP was over $15 trillion. We're actually below 100% of GDP. Now, I know I'm using a lot of numbers right now, and I'm going to use more because that's part of the problem and one of the reasons we are $27.4 trillion in debt is we only speak about need, we only talk in terms of compassion. We all have compassion. We all want to fulfill those needs. We just don't talk in numbers very often. We don't analyze the data. We don't take a look at what we did in the past and see, did it work?
Oh, I love looking at the past and trying to figure out whether some of the actions taken by congressional lawmakers have worked or failed. Now, of course, there have been a lot of failures, and I'd like to point to one that involved Republican Senator Ron Johnson. This is from the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel, a headline that says, U.S. Senator Ron Johnson backs tax cuts, dismisses $1 trillion projected increase in federal debt, because they don't actually care about the debt. Do they love tax cuts? Of course they do. Do they love spending any of our resources on actually benefiting the American people, especially during a time of crisis? Of course not. And that's what that speech was really about. It was a giant middle finger to the American people who are truly suffering right now due to no fault of their own, a virus that they couldn't have predicted, a virus that has led to tens of millions of Americans losing their jobs, a virus that has led to more than 300,000 Americans dying. And Ron Johnson stands up there and pretends like he cares about the debt. It's absolutely shameful. And there's virtually no aid for independent mom and pop landlords who, again, do rely on rental property income in order to pay their own bills. And so they're still responsible for paying utilities for their buildings. They're still responsible to pay their property taxes. And some of you might think, no, landlord's bad. Doesn't matter if they're corporate landlords or independent mom and pop landlords. But understand that this has created a situation in which the worst corporations are snatching up these buildings and just continuing to increase the rent. So I'll give you a perfect example. And this was written by David Sirota for the Daily Poster. Please read the full piece because it's fantastic. So at the Goldman Sachs Financial Services Conference on December 9th, Blackstone's billionaire CEO, Stephen Schwarzman, boasted that after the 2008 financial crisis, his firm was able to cash in on the mortgage crisis. At the time, the company was able to buy up foreclosed homes and convert them into rental properties, subsequently plagued by the accusations of dilapidation or excessive fees, all while it received a big financial boost from the government. And guess what? Blackstone is really excited about these independent landlords who have become desperate because they're not getting any aid from the government. They're not able to collect rental income for obvious reasons. And so they're either putting their buildings on the market, which then gets snatched up by people like Schwartzman, or they're being foreclosed on. And so it's going to create a far worse situation for renters down the line. And Congress doesn't care. Congress isn't doing anything about it. As Schwartzman says, you always have winners and losers. Blackstone was a huge winner coming out of the global financial crisis. And I think something similar is going to happen. I bet he does. And you wouldn't, and by the way, wouldn't you know it, despite the country's devastation and public health crisis, Blackstone continues to force their own tenants out on the streets. As Sirota writes, Blackstone has also been evicting residents during the pandemic and has faced a legal showdown in New York or with New York tenants at one of the city's largest rental complexes, which it owns. There, the company has been trying to exempt thousands of units from rent regulation laws. The company has reportedly even kept Manhattan units empty rather than face rent control regulations. And I've certainly seen quite a bit of that here in Los Angeles as well. And look, if Senate Democrats want to actually do something about this, and to be sure, lawmakers like Senator Bernie Sanders have, they've been fighting pretty hard. But they can actually fight harder because, believe it or not, they do have leverage, even though Republicans control the Senate. What do I mean by that? Well, keep in mind that Mitch McConnell just recently admitted that Kelly Loeffler and David Perdue, who are, you know, running in the Senate runoff races in Georgia, are currently being hounded due to the lack of direct checks to Americans. Of course, this is part of the relief package negotiations, something that Mitch McConnell was not in favor of in any way at all. However, once he realized that this could hurt the chances of Loeffler and Perdue getting reelected, he jumped on a call with GOP lawmakers and urged them to send a direct check to Americans. Now, that's important because we know that Republicans don't want to lose control of the Senate. And so since Democrats have that leverage, why not use it? There's also one other thing that's not getting a lot of attention. Turns out that Donald Trump wants, whether you believe him or not, he's on the record claiming that he wants a more robust relief package for Americans. Here's what he said to Brian Kilmeade in the past weekend.
What about an aid package for the American
it's
people?
Moving along.
What could you do to get the $900 billion out?
Well,
from
I want to do it.
Mitch
I'm
McConnell.
Pushing it very hard. And to be honest with you, if the Democrats really wanted to do the deal, they do the deal. They should do it right now. I want to see checks going for more money than they're talking about going to people.
Democrats should use that soundbite, and they should use it aggressively, and they should use that leverage against the Senate GOP, which, of course, has served as an obstacle in getting a robust relief package to Americans. But unfortunately, we do have a number of feckless, self-interested Democratic lawmakers like Senator Warner, who is one of the wealthiest members of Congress. He's a Democrat, and in regard to what progressives have been demanding, he's gotten a little salty. And here's what he said on a recent interview with MSNBC.
I mean, we're dealing with a Senate that is still unfortunately controlled by the Republicans. We still have Donald Trump as president, controlling two-thirds, in a sense, of the federal government, the executive and the Senate. And the alternative would have been to have people get kicked off of unemployment, get kicked out of their apartments, not get the kind of food assistance that's needed. The Republican deal was sitting at $500 billion. And frankly, there had not even been any conversations between leadership.
So he sounds like he's not really interested in fighting or using any of the leverage that Senate Democrats have in demanding more for the American people. I want to reiterate, the New York Times reported that McConnell said Senators Kelly Loeffler and David Perdue, who are both facing January runoffs that will determine which party controls the Senate, something very important for Republicans, right? We're getting hammered for Congress's failure to deliver more pandemic aid to struggling Americans, particularly the direct payments, and that enacting the measure could help them. I would dangle those Senate races right before them and, again, just flex your muscle, Democrats. fight and do the right thing. But as I shared in a segment with you all last weekend, the truth is when you have incredibly wealthy people allegedly representing us in Congress, they're so far disconnected from the realities that we face on a daily basis. They just don't get it. And so we get insulted with a proposal of a one-time $600 check, or maybe no check at all. But in this case, I think if Democrats understood the leverage they had and they were willing to fight a little harder, they could get something done to not only prevent people from getting evicted in a temporary period of time, but more importantly, provide actual rental assistance so people aren't kicked out of their home as soon as that moratorium is lifted. That hasn't been addressed. I don't know if it's going to be addressed, but it is a big problem that seems like no one's paying much attention to.
Yeah, I mean, it just added up to the myriad ways in which our political class, ruling class, has just completely left us in the lurch during this economic crisis fueled by the pandemic. I mean, it's weird because a lot of this stuff, you know, obviously there's a ton of pain happening right now, but it's almost like the pandemic has frozen a lot of it, you know, like has frozen things in place. And it will only get much, there's a way in which it's going to get worse once everything kind of quote unquote goes back to normal. Because like you said, people are going to start collecting those checks that they're owed. You know, it's going to create all kinds of chaos, both in the housing market, the commercial real estate market, all these things like are just going to be in a very, very precarious place. And in just it's hard to imagine what's going to happen. I mean, there is such a deep and broad economic crisis that's happening right now that, again, like something, it's either going to like, we're either going to sort of emerge from this with some sort of big kind of New Deal type thing. And I'm not necessarily thinking that's going to happen right now or with this current Biden administration or whatever, but like the country is really kind of at a major, major inflection point in which we're either going to come out of it with this big kind of 21st century New Deal or just kind of fall into a permanent state of downward spiral, permanent crisis, and just kind of like a mass underclass that is just much bigger than it ever has been in our history. I mean, it really is wild to think about. You look at something like this and you look at just how absent it is from the chatter, the political conversation, the negotiations going on Capitol Hill, all of those things. And it boggles the mind. I mean, it really boggles the mind. Again, I just don't know what is going to come out of this. I mean, it's going to create a political instability unlike we haven't seen in our lifetimes.
Yeah, I mean, and I know that at least in Los Angeles, you can already see the impact of what's going on. I mean, of course, we had a problem with homelessness even before the pandemic, but that problem has really exploded during this pandemic. And I mean, when it comes to local lawmakers, like, what have they done? Oh, let's put a porta potty underneath the bridge and that'll be good enough. No, but it's insane because that's actually what was tried back in, I think, the early 1990s. And it ended up being a massive failure because people were using the porta potties for drug trafficking and all sorts of other crime. And it did nothing to actually, you know, help with any type of public health concern. You know, during the AIDS epidemic, HIV epidemic, there were like housing programs because the government realized that this is a public health issue, right? And it's better to keep people housed in a clean, safe place rather than have them, you know, out on the streets, possibly, you know, spreading this. But we don't have that kind of mindset right now in this country. Yeah. Like things are so like far in like this neoliberal profit-driven direction that we're having conversations about, okay, what more can we do to bail out these businesses? I'm not talking about small businesses, like these corporations. I mean, the Federal Reserve printing money, all of that is totally fine. But when it comes to sending direct checks to Americans who are in need right now, they're totally nickel and diming us. 8 million more Americans fell into poverty since the last summer. That's insane. It's insane. And I think more than anything, guys, what it shows me is just how the left has no power, because if we did, then we would be able to do something about this. Congress isn't afraid of us. They're not afraid of us at all, at all. And I think that's something that needs to be addressed.
Yeah, and anyway, ultimately, I mean, the presence of 500,000 homeless people in the richest country in the world is just utterly, like, it's one of those things that when I think about it, it drives me absolutely crazy. And yeah, I mean, ultimately, our goal should be to decommodify the housing market pretty much entirely. I mean, it should not be something subject to the whims of the market. It just shows that the market cannot satisfy housing for all. I mean, it just can't. So again, you know, decommodify the things that we need in our lives. That should be a principle that we stick to over and over again, whether it's food, housing, medical care, education, all those things need to be decommodified. Sure, we can have like for shoes and stuff, we can have companies competing with each other and things like that. But for the things that we actually need in our lives, it just needs to be completely decommodified.
No, I totally agree with you. And you know, when it comes to like rent control, for instance, I mean, it goes back to a very familiar theme on this show. You know, you can try to regulate a privatized industry, right? But it's never going to be enough, because with rent control in LA, this pandemic has shown how weak rent control is. Because what ends up happening is, okay, these like mom and pop landlords can't afford to keep paying property taxes and, you know, utilities and everything for these buildings, for their tenants. And so they're putting this stuff back on the market, or they're being foreclosed on, which allows vultures like Schwartzman to come in and snatch them up. But understand what they do. They don't keep the rent controlled buildings. What they do is they demolish them, and then they build these luxury condos or luxury apartment buildings that are overpriced, and they do sit empty. And it blows my mind. Like, that was a big problem even before the pandemic. And now this pandemic and the inaction by our lawmakers is putting that problem on overdrive. Yeah. So we're going to really see this housing crisis explode in the next year. And Congress is just not up for the challenge at all. They don't care to do anything about it. And since we're, you know, having a discussion about power and what we can do, I think it's important to bring David Sirota in now, who's been discussing strategy, debating strategy about, you know, what progressives can do to win all week. I'm sure you're exhausted by this conversation, David, but thank you for joining us.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
So, look, I think set some ground rules, because I really want to have a substantive discussion and not make this about any type of personalities. And so this is specifically about strategy and what we can do to use whatever leverage progressive lawmakers have in the House to get things done. And so there has been a proposal to hold the vote for Nancy Pelosi as Speaker of the House. And unless she agrees to taking Medicare for All to a floor vote, then progressive lawmakers should avoid voting for her. And so that's a little bit of leverage that progressive lawmakers have. And there's been a big debate all week about whether or not that strategy makes a lot of sense. And so, David, I really appreciated your piece in, you know, the Daily Poster, where you provided some specific nuanced examples of other things that progressives can do in addition to a Medicare for All floor vote. So do you want to just quickly talk about what those options are?
Sure. You know, I think there's a lot of things that the House Democrats could try to do if they wanted to. And to leverage that vote for Nancy Pelosi. For instance, they don't have to just ask for a vote on Medicare for All. They could ask for a vote on two or three or four bills that are in Congress that deal with the same issue. For instance, Ro Khanna has an existing bill to allow states to help states do their own single-payer Medicare for All programs. And if you know the history of Medicare for All in, for instance, a place like Canada, you know that it started at the provincial level. So actually passing something that empowers the states to take action is historically has been helpful. It engages state legislators. We don't actually know where members of Congress really are on that issue. And we have an HHS secretary or an incoming HHS secretary who has said he actually supports doing that kind of thing. So getting folks on record on an issue like that, in addition to a Medicare for All floor vote, is something that you can ask for. You can ask the Democrats and Pelosi and the Democratic leadership to put a letter together, an initiative together, to tell Joe Biden to use the existing executive authority that he will have to expand Medicare in the middle of this pandemic. We haven't seen any organizing around that. I mean, the incredible thing to me, which is sort of sad, is that there's sort of this idea out there that Joe Biden won the election, therefore that's over. So whatever Joe Biden does is fine and can't really, you know, fight it or pressure him, and that we have to focus only for now on what's going on, for instance, in the U.S. House. It sort of gives a pass to Joe Biden, as opposed to saying Joe Biden actually will have the power with the stroke of a pen to expand Medicare if he wanted to. Why hasn't there been any organizing around that? Why haven't the House Democrats, the Democrats in Congress, moved aggressively to put the pressure on him to do that? So that's another thing. The other thing that can be done right now, which is directly right in the House, which I know some people roll their eyes at because it's I guess technical or wonky. I don't particularly think it is to replace the chair of the House Ways and Means Committee with somebody, right now it's somebody who opposes Medicare for All, and put in a Medicare for All supporter. And that's not a small thing, that's a huge thing. If you know the history of Medicare itself, you would know how important it is to have a Ways and Means Committee chairperson, because that's the committee that oversees the legislation. You would know how important it is to have a Medicare for All supporter in that job. The New Yorker did a longer piece about this, I think it was 2 or 3 years ago, about how Ways and Means Committee Chairman Wilbur Mills, back in the 60s, ended up holding up Medicare singularly for years until he was pressured and convinced to move off that. So there's been, those are some ideas. And the problem that I've had with some of the discussion here is that these are ideas to say, yes, a Medicare for All vote would be important, but we need to actually ask for more in order to expect to get anything. That what we have learned over and over again from Congress is that if you don't ask for a whole loaf, you probably won't get a crumb. If you ask for a crumb, you'll get nothing. So in asking for only one thing that is important, but doesn't really put Nancy Pelosi necessarily in a position where she really doesn't want to have to do something. If you don't ask for that, then it's not clear you're going to get much of anything. And the thing that's been disturbing is that even just saying that, which I think is a logical, earnest, honest kind of statement, even saying that has generated recriminations of, oh, people are selling out, people are corrupt, people are trying to help the Democratic establishment. And the problem is that we need to be able to discuss issues of tactics and strategy without it devolving into, if you disagree with me on strategy, or not even if you disagree with me, if you want to add something to the strategy, that must mean you are an evil, corrupt, self-dealing establishment hack. And that is not helpful to anyone. It is not helpful to the movement. It is not helpful to the outcome of actually guaranteeing healthcare to all, an outcome that lots of us have been working for decades on.
Yeah. And I just, Nando, sorry, I wanted to just add one quick thing to it, because, you know, David mentioned the House Ways and Means Committee. And I agree with you. Out of all of the different you know, kind of proposals you had in your piece, that was the one that appealed to me the most, because the chair of the House Ways and Means Committee is Richie Neal, who is awful, absolutely awful, and has successfully defeated efforts to end surprise medical billing. He's very much in cahoots with the private healthcare industry, and getting rid of him or shifting the power away from a corporate Democrat and to, you know, an actual progressive is really important in that committee. I agree with you. I don't think that's wonky at all. And it actually,
let's be clear. I want to just make one point about that. One additional point. That is something that Nancy Pelosi could like literally do. Like she could do that today, like now. Like if she woke up today and was like, I don't want Richard Neal to be the chairman of the Ways and Means Committee. That could happen like right now with her essentially singularly. So that's an ask, a demand that she could actually deliver on herself. She can't even, for the most part, she can't even really say, well, look, I got to get this member or that member to agree to it. She is literally running for speaker. The job of the speaker is to appoint the chair. So that's an ask that's actually even more singularly to Nancy Pelosi than any ask.
And I want to ask you, David, because I'm meaning to ask you something about this, because a lot of the focus has been on AOC and her whatever parliamentary kind of maneuver she decides to do on this. I want to ask, because on the one hand, there's this push to get her to, maybe withhold her vote against Pelosi to get these concessions. While at the same time, there was just the news broke yesterday that there was like a secret meeting in which they kind of excluded her from the Energy and Commerce Committee. It's all very kind of like inside the Capitol, and it's something that I don't understand that well. And I just wanted to ask you, like, how much power can AOC like credibly threaten Pelosi's speakership? And what did you make of this kind of maneuver on the Energy and Commerce Committee?
Look, I think that the who becomes speaker is ultimately there is a full vote of the House, and each party votes for their potential speaker candidate. Typically, what happens is that each party first has a meeting of their committee or their conference, and they have an internal election. Frankly, it's not binding. The only binding election is the actual official House vote, but they have a non-binding intra-party election to say, here's who is our speaker designate that we'll put on the floor to vote on. And so in theory, if enough Democrats withheld their vote for speaker, for their own party's speaker designate, then neither party would have a majority necessary to elect a House speaker. And things can get haywire at that point. I lived in Montana as one example. I lived in Montana where this very kind of thing happened. And what ended up happening was you had a Democratic House majority in Montana with a Republican speaker. Now, I'm not saying that's going to happen here. But what I'm saying is that things can get pretty chaotic and dicey. And that is real leverage that progressives in the House have. And I think it's been important to underscore that leverage exists and it can be used. That has been a very important and good thing that has been underscored today. Where it goes from there, I don't know. I don't think anybody knows. I mean, the next in line who's been angling for speaker is Hakeem Jeffries, who's also a conservative, corporate-friendly Democrat. Would you get conservative Democrats actually voting for a quote-unquote moderate Republican House member? I put that in quotes because I'm not sure there are any moderates. I mean, we just don't know. But I think a game of brinksmanship is important if you're trying to extract concessions from Pelosi, especially concessions, again, concessions that I believe should be the absolute minimum that should be expected. A floor vote on Medicare for All, a floor vote on Ro Khanna's bill about state Medicare for All legislation. I mean, this shouldn't even be hard for Nancy Pelosi to deliver. It isn't hard for her to deliver because it's on the Medicare for All vote. I don't think I'm undermining the Medicare for All movement, but I think we would all agree that it is probably doomed to fail. Doesn't mean it's not important. It is important as an organizing tool, but it's already probably a predetermined outcome. So the fact that isn't the expectation already tells us a lot about how rigged the system already is against guaranteeing healthcare to all Americans. And I want to bring up something else from history about this. We know that the Democratic Party has tried to avoid uncomfortable votes on healthcare from 12 years ago. I was thinking about this last night. I was remembering the history of this. 12 years ago, there was a whole effort to force the Senate Democrats to vote to allow a floor vote on a public health insurance option, something that's even more modest than Medicare for All. I was part of the campaign here in Colorado to pressure my Democratic senator to use his power, because every senator had the power, to call for an open floor vote on a public option at the end of the debate on the Affordable Care Act. And not one Democrat stood up to even call for a vote. Now, there was a strategic argument there. The argument was that if we allow for amendments on this bill, it will allow the Republicans to offer amendments. And if the bill gets changed, it will go back to the House, and the Affordable Care Act itself, the whole bill may end up getting taken down. I didn't agree with that strategy. I absolutely didn't agree with that strategy. I thought that argument was wrong. However, and this is an important point, the people who were making that argument, I didn't think that people in the labor movement, I didn't think that Bernie Sanders, I didn't think that progressive Democrats, who ultimately essentially accepted that strategy, I didn't think they were sellouts. I didn't accuse them, of not being on the same page. It got heated, but you know, it was like, you know, good faith allies can disagree tactically on good faith efforts to try to achieve a goal. I think, but I also think at the same time that back then the Democrats created the situation by which it was harder to even get a vote. In other words, it wasn't coincidental that just getting an open floor vote in the Senate on a public option was considered controversial or potentially strategically dangerous. That was, in a sense, an engineered situation to try to prevent a vote. So all of that goes back to the idea that while a vote at one level on any of these issues should be an easy ask, there is a clear pattern, a history of the Democratic Party not even wanting to hold an open vote on these issues. And I think it's because ultimately they don't want to get crosswise with a very powerful industry, the healthcare industry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, okay. So let's talk about a floor vote actually happening, right? Somehow miraculously AOC and the rest of the progressive lawmakers in the House are able to use this leverage against Pelosi to get her to agree to a floor vote in the House. And, you know, I think everyone agrees that it's unlikely to pass, the Senate. So the argument is, well, the floor vote is important, even if it's not going to pass in the Senate, because at least in the House, we'll know which Democrats are real about wanting to pass Medicare for All. But I mean, if I were a slimy, sketchy Democrat who wanted to pretend that I liked Medicare for All and would vote for it, if I know it's going to fail in the Senate, yeah, it's perfect cover. Like, I voted for Medicare for All, and it was the Senate that, you know, destroyed our opportunity here. I just feel like it's not going to play out the way that some of the fans of this strategy are hoping for, right? I just feel like this isn't actually going to reveal much.
I guess I agree with you, but I would also say I don't see a big downside to it. I think that, mm-hmm. I think that, okay, let's imagine a vote happens, all the co-sponsors vote for it, it doesn't pass the House, it has fired up people, which is good, getting people on record actually casting a vote for it, actually good, even if some of those votes are fraudulent, the idea being fraudulent, mm-hmm. like if and when a Medicare for All vote comes up where it actually, we really think it has a chance to pass, it's part of a larger legislative strategy, some of those people, beg off and actually flip their votes, it's good to have them on record right now. All of that is good. I think the issue we're having is that to hold up this one tactic as a litmus test for whether you support the cause, whether you, activist groups, advocacy groups, whether this tactic alone is the holy grail. That's actually what we're talking about here, which is a nuanced point and an important point to unpack. I reject the idea that this one tactic is the silver bullet to solving healthcare in America. I agree that the tactic is important and helpful, but to hold it up as the one holy grail And to further say this is the only tactic that matters, and that all the other work that's going on, all the state efforts, all the effort to potentially get rid of a current chairperson who's in the power position to actually block this bill, everything else is not important. The only thing that's important is this tactic, I think, sets up the movement to fail. I think that's because we know the vote itself will probably fail. So I think at a tactical level, I'm a supporter of the idea that there should be a floor vote. I am not a supporter of the idea that the floor vote is the only thing that matters, and everyone else who's working on this in all sorts of different ways, everyone else has no value. Everyone else is a sellout and a corporate hack. Like that's what's the problem here. We have to be able to walk and chew gum at the same time. We have to be able to be civil with one another if we agree that we're all trying to actually achieve the same thing. I can disagree with you on a tactic. You can tell me, you know, here's why you think the floor vote is the Holy Grail. But we can have that conversation without you saying, well, this means, if you disagree with me, that you're actually working for the health insurance companies, you're actually working for Big Pharma, and you actually want to, torpedo this entire movement that you've been working on for 25 years. And it's not me, about everybody. It's an absurd, I want to just say one other thing. It is also counterproductive in a bigger way.
I know, David, but I'm sorry, I keep interrupting you, Nando, but let me just say, I think the mistake that you're making, and let me also be clear on something. I think there are people engaged in this debate who agree with the tactic, who agree with the strategy, and they are coming at this in an honest, sincere way. I respect that, and I love that they're engaging in this discussion, and I think this debate is really important. Just right now, as we're doing the show, I'm going to break my own ground rule. Jimmy Dore keeps accusing me of taking money from NATO. Like, he's insane. He's literally out of his mind, batshit crazy. Like, accusing people of things that you have no evidence of. I personally took $20 million from Jeffrey Katzenberg simply because I didn't immediately fall in line and say this is fantastic. I don't even want to discuss it. 100% support it. We can't have a discussion about anything else. We need to do this and let's move on. Like, that's not a good faith person. Well, I think there are people who agree with him, right? And I'm interested in having a discussion with them. Not interested in having a discussion with someone who has no evidence for anything and goes around, you know, slinging mud and you know, causing these ridiculous divisions within, you know, a group of people who overwhelmingly agree with one another on these issues.
Right. I think there's I think there's something bigger than just any one personality. I think it's that you have to be able to honestly assess who is on your side and who isn't. And frankly, I don't think it's that hard to figure out who's on your side and who isn't. In other words, it's pretty clear who the corporate Democrats are. It's pretty clear who the progressive supporters of Medicare for All are. By the way, a floor vote would help make that as clear as possible, I think, or at least more clear in the U.S. House of Representatives itself. But I think that, you know, demonizing people that we all know are actually on the side of this fight, demonizing them because they may disagree or have different views about what the best strategy is, that is deeply counterproductive. And let's use AOC as an example. Okay. If AOC does not, and the squad does not use their leverage to force a floor vote or try to force a floor vote, I'm not prepared to say that means that they don't believe in Medicare for All or that they're sellouts. I'm not prepared to. The evidence is overwhelmingly against that. That they may disagree with the tactic, and I may disagree with them for their position on the tactic on not forcing a Medicare for All vote. But I'm not willing to say, nor do I believe, that that means that they don't want to pass Medicare for All or aren't willing to fight as hard as possible for Medicare for All. It could just be that they have a different theory of change. And when you take a strategic difference and try to broaden it to be a difference of values, if you don't have evidence that is rational and logical to do that, what you're doing is you're undermining people who are really on your side. and who are trying to do the right thing. I mean, if you tell me, I'll say this. If you tell me, look, AOC and the squad are not going to force a vote, and I just found out that their super PAC got a huge, you know, $500,000 from Aetna, then you can say, hey, listen, this looks like they sold out, right? But if you tell me they're not going to use their leverage to force a floor vote on Medicare for All, because they want it, they actually have an idea to, for instance, use their leverage to change, I don't know, House PAYGO rules, right? The budget rules that make it impossible to actually pass Medicare for All in a real way. If you tell me that that means that they're selling out to the insurance companies and you don't have evidence, there's no proof, there's no rational, documented proof that they're acting in a nefarious way, then asserting that they're acting in a corrupt, nefarious way is both not really credible and also deeply destructive to the larger movement. And again, this is a movement that has been going on for a very long time. Now, I know there are critics out there who say, well, look, you know, anybody who's been working on this for a long time, it means that you don't know what you're doing because we haven't passed Medicare for All by now. So all the work you've been doing for the last 20, 30 years, actually it proves that you're pathetic and a failure because you haven't passed Medicare for All yet. Well, that writes out the history of how powerful the interests really are. That writes out the history of every social movement that takes decades to achieve its goals. And so my point is, moving forward, is to try to understand who our enemies are, who they are, who our allies are, and understand that among allies there are going to be disagreements and there are going to be vehement disagreements. But personalizing them and using them to assert corruption, using them to assert a lack of moral principle when you're having a tactical dispute, that is deeply destructive to the entire movement for the actual issue and the actual outcome.
Yeah, and the other thing that's the other thing that's kind of been on my mind about this whole debate is the sort of over-focus on just internal parliamentary maneuvers. I mean, you mentioned the passage of Medicare in the 1960s. And when any big, broad policy like this has been passed in the past, a bunch of like what we would call quote unquote corporate sellouts voted for them. You know what I mean? And it was just because they were forced to by a sort of shift in the balance of power from forces outside of the halls of Congress. I mean, you know, Lyndon Johnson has a very mixed record as a senator in the sort of things he believed and the things he supported and the things he crushed often when he was a senator, and then he oversaw the passage of Medicare. So the purity of Lyndon Johnson was never really an important debate to be having. I mean, everyone knows that he was kind of a power hungry person who was willing to do anything for power and were willing to just compromise on anything for that. So, but it was the shift in conditions that came after decades of organizing a powerful labor movement, a civil rights movement, things like that, that were able to shift the political terrain outside of the halls of Congress, so that a bunch of these, what we would call corporate sellouts, ended up actually voting for it. So it just strikes me as like an overfocus on this as some sort of tactic that's going to essentially be kind of like a game genie cheat code in the Nintendo game, you know, and skip three or four levels.
There is no cheat code. There's no up.
There is no cheat code.
No, that doesn't work in politics like that. And I agree with you. But I would also say that's why there's two things happening here at once, which is the value of a Medicare for All vote is not that you're going to actually create a Medicare for All program, because that, if you believe that, and I want to be clear, it's not that you're going to pass a Medicare for All program now. Obviously, the goal is to pass a Medicare for All program generally. But the value of a vote right now is not that you're going to actually tomorrow legislate Medicare for All. I think we can all be honest and agree that that's probably not going to happen. Because we don't live in a political system where the tail can wag the dog, right? The tail being like you have to do the organizing work and the engagement over many, many, many years to challenge power to actually, that's what history teaches, to actually deliver on a policy this big. And that delivering on a policy this big that challenges power in this way is not something you just sort of get through with just exactly the right worded bill if you haven't done all the other things. But I do think the value of a vote is for those other things, right? So to have a vote is part, one of many different things that can be done to help add fuel to the larger movement. And so that's why it's important, but it's also why if you hold it up as the holy grail, you're being dishonest, right? It can be important and also not be the holy grail. Pushing for a vote right now can be an important thing to do right now, but saying that it's the only thing we need to do, and then when it fails, being crushed and saying, well, it failed, so I guess we're done. That if you frame it that way, that's not helpful to the long-term cause. It is one step, an important step, but it is one step.
Okay, perfect. So that leads to the question that I have, because I don't know, maybe I'm missing it, because I think a floor vote is fine. And I think that every argument I heard about how it can be quote unquote damaging isn't strong enough to convince me that we shouldn't have a floor vote. But my question has been, okay, then what comes after that? So if it fails, what do we do? Like, what is the plan? Because, you know, as Ryan Grimm mentioned in a thread, he writes, consider the fact that the left basically has no power right now. You can't maneuver your way out of powerlessness. There's no clever trick that abolitionists could have pulled in 1820 that would have ended slavery, even though there were a few members of Congress against slavery. And so I think that's a really important point, because, all right, let's have the floor vote. And the idea is the lawmakers, the Democratic lawmakers who are not on board for Medicare for All, there should be consequences. So what are the consequences? The left has no power. Like, let's be real about where we are. We don't have power. We're not organized.
Right.
We're not even planning. We're not even having that discussion right now. No one is having that discussion.
Well, look, this is why I say the Ro Khanna bill is so important. I mean, you really have to play this out for a sec. The bill to further empower the HHS secretary to provide waivers to states to create their own Medicare for All systems, basically vastly expanding Medicaid to cover everybody. You need a lot of waivers. It's fairly esoteric and complex, but it's important. The reason why that is so politically important, separating out the details, is because it would then empower hundreds, if not thousands, of state legislators to become deeply engaged on the issue, because it would give them agency to actually take action on this in states across the country. If you think like a movement person rather than only a media spectacle, if you're thinking about the power dynamics here, giving state legislators, and this is just one example, but giving state legislators the power to say, hey, if you pass a Medicare for All or single payer program in your state, you will get those necessary waivers to actually fund what you are doing. You have now empowered those legislators to become community and state advocates for this policy in a very real way. Not rhetorical advocates, but actually legislative advocates. Advocates who can go to their constituents and say, I am trying to do this right now that would create this here in our community. So when you ask the question, what comes next? That's exactly the right question to be asking. And that's why when I wrote my article about all the things that can be done, that's what was on my mind, right? One thing, empower state legislators essentially to go out and be campaigners for this in their own communities in a concrete way. That is a policy point, and it's also a political point. The primarying point that you brought up, a Medicare for All floor vote would clarify, or at least better clarify, who is willing to align themselves as publicly as possible, who in the House is willing to align themselves as publicly as possible with Medicare for All. It would give us more detail than just the co-sponsor list. And in theory, you could then take that vote, that roll call vote, figure out who represents deeply blue districts, and how many people who are voting against Medicare for All are actually wildly out of step with the political situation in their district. And that can be useful to then, in theory, try to target primaries properly. So again, that's useful. But the issue is that you have to be thinking about those steps before you ask or plan around a particular tactic. Now, there's no central place where all these tactics are put together. And that's why I think, you know, there is value in trying to push for a vote right now, in that it is in some ways a spontaneous moment here. And I think that's, you don't want to tamp down that energy. That energy is really important, but it is also important to have it be energy in service of a larger plan, because what you don't want to happen is that vote happens, it gets voted down, and then everyone says, I told you, see, the system is corrupt. We should all just, you know, disengage, disinvest from the entire system, and ends up being a demoralizing event. And it ends up being a moment of really nihilism. Now, look, I'm the first person to tell you that the system is corrupt. I report on corruption literally every single day. But what you don't want to have happen is that this ends up being even more fuel for a nihilistic politics that says it's actually worthwhile for everybody to simply disengage, because nothing can ever fundamentally change.
I want to ask you, just sort of moving on from the Medicare for All aspect of it, but one thing that I was thinking a lot about is that it strikes me that if to the small extent that the left has power within Congress, if it can credibly knock down Pelosi from the speakership, even if she's replaced by some awful person like Hakeem Jeffries, like, it strikes me as that in and of itself is almost like a worthwhile muscle flex to be like, we took down Pelosi. Like, symbolically, she's a lot. I mean, she's been around forever. She's one of the most powerful Democrats in the country. Beyond like where she fits on a sort of theoretical political spectrum vis-a-vis someone like Hakeem Jeffries, her actual power is much larger than Hakeem Jeffries. She's just got much more prestige, much better fundraising skills and experience, much more credibility within the media, blah blah blah, a million things. That it strikes me that just bringing down Pelosi, just knocking her off that perch, if that is really in the like on the table, and they do have the power to do that, I almost would rather that than a Medicare for All floor vote as a sort of symbolic victory, as like a sort of threat that, you know, we can do this, we can knock out Nancy Pelosi, you know, is vulnerable to our power. I mean, that strikes me as in a way a much more, I don't know, scary threat to someone who would be in that position.
I absolutely agree that taking out Nancy Pelosi would be a huge achievement, even if her successor is sort of a caretaker, placeholder, continuity with her own politics. Yes, these that kind of a victory would be an earthquake. Look, I was part of an earthquake like that. In a sense, in 2006, when I worked for Ned Lamont, he didn't even win the general election in Connecticut, but he won the primary. And I would argue that primary victory changed the Democratic Party's entire posture on the Iraq War. Also, in changing the Democratic Party's entire posture on the Iraq War, helped the Democrats win the Congress in 2006 and helped the Democrats win the presidency in 2008. So, yes, showing that you can actually defeat somebody can certainly create the kind of deterrent and sort of constructive political fear in the establishment to force change. I think that's absolutely true. And look, I think that Alex Morse tried to do that with Richie Neal in the primary against Richie Neal. It wasn't successful, but it doesn't mean it wasn't worthwhile. I mean, if you asked me to map out how are you actually going to change the politics of the United States House of Representatives, you know, my view is that you have to primary enough people and successfully primary enough people to make it clear that if Democratic lawmakers, especially from very Democratic districts, continue voting against working people in this country, they'll face political consequences. You have to get critical mass of enough of those on a consistent enough basis to actually create a different culture, a culture in which the Democratic elected officials have to fear selling out regular people. that culture obviously doesn't exist yet in the U.S. House. I don't know if it ever will. And I think, but I do think that the squad and the younger members of Congress, the freshman members of Congress coming in, some of them who defeated Democratic incumbents, I think that's very, very helpful to changing that culture in the House. The Senate's a whole other problem. There has not been a successful progressive primary, whether an open seat or an incumbent primary, to defeat a Democratic senator. I mean, it just hasn't happened. I can't name one. I mean, and I would argue that in 2020, the Democratic Party machine actually came to its pinnacle of power in actually preventing any real progressive, other than maybe Raphael Warnock in Georgia, from being the Democratic nominee in a Senate primary. That if you look across each individual Senate race, the Democratic Party machine in Washington was able to handpick its candidate and prevent an insurgent progressive candidate from even becoming the Democratic Senate nominee. So the Senate's a whole other problem.
Yeah. The Senate is a problem in many, 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 yeah. many ways. Yeah. Yeah. So, yeah. Well, yeah. I don't know. Well, Anna, do you have anything? Yeah.
Yeah, I actually wanted to invite our producer, Kale, because I know he had a question that he wanted to ask, if I understood his text correctly. Hey, Kale.
Hey, guys. Hey, David. Good to see you. Hey there. No, less of a question, more of just something I wanted to contribute to the conversation and maybe see where it goes, because something that's left out of a lot of this when we're talking about expanding healthcare, whether it's the reforms of let's expand existing coverage, let's expand Medicaid or Medicare, or whether it's, moving to single payer, I think it's important that we look back to the history of how other countries in the world actually got single payer, because, in some ways, the American experience through this is in line with these other countries, and in other ways, it's not. In large part, most of these other countries did it because they had a massive labor movement and they had a labor party that either was the one that implemented the policy or was the one that, because of their existence, put enough pressure on the more liberal or conservative political parties to go along with that, that it was through the threat of labor, of organized labor, of basically, we will shut down the economy, we will harm profit rates if you don't guarantee healthcare to our citizens. And so, one little thing I would quibble with, David, that you said a moment ago, with there is no one central place where people are, where the Medicare for All push is happening. It's true in some sense, but there is a coalition that has been in existence for a while now, of various progressive groups of NNU, PNHP, Healthcare Now, DSA, and others, and they won a floor vote, but their strategy, different than what this whole debate's been about, was we go into these districts where you have politicians that are opposed to Medicare for All, and you ask the politician, will you sign on to Medicare for All? When they say no, you then canvass their district until the constituents in that district demand that their politician end up acting on this. And in some ways, it's a crude substitute for what the history shows us, which is that it takes a labor movement. It takes the threat of profitability in order to get this. But it might still be the case in America that we will not have Medicare for All unless we have strike action from various important unions. That might be the reality, but we don't know that yet. But it seems like no matter what we do, the strategy going forward has to involve some kind of building of class capacity, that whether it's, these reforms to expanding healthcare have to in some way lead to our base of people that are on our side, working people and kind of a broader constituency of some middle class people, that they have to be able to accumulate power through this process. They have greater autonomy to fight more, in the off hours when they're not at work, or unions don't have to bargain have to be in such a precarious bargaining position with their employers so that they can then demand more, whether it's through healthcare or other, on other fronts as well as wages and and working conditions. But it seems like all of that has largely been lost so far in the debate that has been happening for the last week or so, that like it's mostly been about what do you think, what do you believe, how do you feel, what's in the minds of someone else, and not like what are the actual social forces necessary to actually carry this fight forward, whether it's, you know, in one fell swoop or whether it's, you know, chipping away at this process.
Well,
sorry to throw so much on you.
Yeah, there's a lot to unpack there. I mean, I would say that, you know, ultimately the political system responds to the pressure brought to bear on it. And right now, the pressure that's brought to bear on it is mostly corporate pressure, mostly corporate influence. The organized labor, the proverbial left, if you will, has such little power in comparison to the power of essentially corporatist politics. So essentially what we're really talking, the inability to pass Medicare for All, even though polls show that Americans, if you ask them, say they support government guaranteed healthcare, the inability to actually get Congress to respond is a reflection on the lack of organized power on the left that exists. And so anything you can do to strengthen that power will ultimately, in theory, help you better able to achieve something like Medicare for All in the Congress. But the unfortunate thing is that, you know, a lot of people want easy solutions. And I get it, people are impatient. And progress takes a long time. It's unglamorous, it's a slog. It's not something spectacular. It just takes years and years of work. You know, I mean, electing a city council person, electing a state legislator, these things are not super high profile, but they're important because those, you know, city councilor becomes the next congressperson who becomes the next senator who becomes the next, you know, president, et cetera, et cetera. And I think that, you know, we're encouraged in this culture to want instant gratification and think that there are these, you know, cheat codes, if you will. I like that metaphor, that there are these cheat codes to just make this all go faster. But our history, and it's not just our history, it's human history. I mean, literally, like, human history has taught that that's typically not the way things work. And, you know, I wish I had a better answer to that. I don't have a better answer to that. I do think, though, that the current economic crisis is probably going to accelerate the potential for change. And that's both, I mean, I'm not rooting for the economic crisis. Obviously, it's awful. It's a horrible thing. But I think it offers a potential for opportunity, but also a potential for peril. And I wrote my second book basically about this. It was called The Uprising. And the premise of the book was basically if the left, essentially the left and right are having a competition for who can best channel the right, righteous, and understandable outrage of the population at a political system that is owned by big money. And I think we've been in that since I wrote the book, and now it's really culminating now. And that if the left cannot put forward, and the left by that I mean not just the activist left, I mean the left of center of politics, even including parts of the Democratic Party, refuses to offer up a program that will actually deliver material gains for people, then the right will opportunistically purport to put up such a program in order to gain power for itself. I think that's what happened with Donald Trump. I think that's what will happen with the next Donald Trump, who could be even more dangerous if we have 4 years of Joe Biden essentially making sure that nothing fundamentally changes. Those are his words. So I think we are at an incredibly important moment right now that will determine potentially the next many decades of our politics in ways that could be either exciting and positive or terrifying and deeply destructive.
Well, David, thank you for taking the time to come on our show after doing so many other shows all week talking about the same issue.
My pleasure. My pleasure.
Yeah. I really appreciate the conversation. It is an important conversation to have. And I think the debate is healthy as long as those engaging in the debate are, you know, doing so in good faith.
Well, I forgot to tell you, I'm doing this interview from, I'm sitting on top of a giant pile of gold coin. I'm going to go back to my job, shilling for the establishment. I've got a lobbying thing.
The problem is, it's my back support is no good. I got to build an ergonomic chair on top of them.
I'll let Bhaskar know that he's got to you know, talk to Bezos again. And
it's
Soros. Don't worry, guys. I'll share my NATO money.
Okay, good. Excellent.
Amazing.
Thank you for having me. I really appreciate it. Thanks, good rest of your weekend. Okay, take care.
You too. Later. Bye. Man, all right. David Sirota he's just a fantastic reporter. He's a fantastic person. And yeah, the attacks on him right now and others, it's just
hilarious.
There's
few people in America who've done better work than Sirota over like the past 25 years.
100%. Yeah. 100%.
No, so he has the Daily Poster, but Jacobin also republishes all of his articles. So if you're, you know, if you have a preference for Jacobin, which, you know, I might want to read it on Jacobin. I think you should too. You should read it there. You should read it wherever you can. You should read Sirota because he's always on point. And even if I disagree with him sometimes, I find him extremely clarifying of the things that I don't fully understand yet. So,
well, you know, he kind of serves a purpose for me similar to like someone like Ryan Grimm, in that they're, you know, we may have like ideological kind of differences or whatever, but they do have their fingers in power in some way. Like they have more access to people in power than you or I do, Kale. You know, we're not talking to members of Congress ever. We're not talking to people.
Speak for yourself, Nando.
Yeah. You got AOC's number. You text with her. So they kind of serve that bridge for me. You know, like where they do. You know, their sort of commitments are beyond reproach, but they also are speaking to people who are making decisions every day about this kind of stuff. So I find it to be useful to speak to them and hear them out.
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
Let's take
a question.
Yeah, we got a couple minutes. People, send us some super chat questions. There's some already that I'll pull up, but yeah, please send us more questions. This is the last show that we're doing of the year. We'll be back in 2020.
2021.
That's right. Fucking hell. Yeah, no, 2021. It's just 2020. It's just part forever. Two.
Yeah, Groundhog 2020. Yeah, Groundhog Day.
Seriously. Yeah. We'll be back next year. Of course, it's going to be bigger, better, badder than ever. In the meantime, just a couple of super chats. Leroy earlier had said, great breakdown of the tech companies. The book Break 'Em Up by Zephyr Teachout is worth reading. So I'll just shout that out. Zephyr Teachout's very good. That Indian dude was asking us to cover the Indian farmer strike. We did that last week. You should watch Nando's.
I want to please tell me that that's the screen name and not just you saying like some Indian dude.
it is shit. Yeah, no, it is the screen name.
That fucking Indian dude is there yapping away again.
When you replay the live chat, it's there, I promise. I didn't just botch someone's name.
We covered the Indian farmer strike.
Yeah. No, last week it was a very good segment. People should watch that. Let's see. So eclectic. Oh, here. Now they're coming.
Now they're coming in, baby.
Okay. So I love David, but isn't a pandemic with millions of new people unemployed, homeless, and don't have food security the time not to be patient, to bring people together with a general strike while also building a movement?
But no one's having a discussion about a general strike. Like literally no one's talking about that. Like that's the problem, right? So the floor vote is fine. I also don't appreciate the amount of dishonesty that's taking place, where people have addressed the issue, have, like David Sirota, agreed that a floor vote could be important, but want a more robust discussion about what follows Medicare for All failing to pass, right? So, but you're not even allowed to have that conversation without, you know, I mean, some of it is like right wingers that have like co-opted this nonsense on social media. Part of it is people who are buying into whatever narrative, certain bad faith actors are putting out there in regard to this, but serious people actually want a solution and want to know, okay, what do we do to leverage, you know, whatever power progressives have in the House? What do we do after it fails? What kind of organizing is taking place? But from everything I've seen, every debate that's taken place on this very issue, it just centers on, should we do the floor vote or not? And that's it. Okay, all right, great, we're here. Let's do the floor vote, right? Let's snap our fingers and somehow the floor vote happens. What happens after that? It's not gonna pass Congress. So what happens after that? Because here's one other thing I'm gonna say. All of us with our YouTube shows, I know we all think we're super influential. We're not. We're not. We're up against the private healthcare industry. We're up against corporate media. We just saw how easily it was to bury Bernie Sanders in the primary with the corporate media narrative. Okay, it happened in 2016. It happened in 2020 as well. And so we need to be real about where we are with our power, and we need to just be honest with ourselves, okay? TYT is a gigantic company. Like, and when I mean company, I mean like it's watched by a lot of people, but millions of people, right? Millions of views every day. It doesn't matter. We're still not influential enough to overwhelm the corporate media narrative. So if the plan is, okay, they're gonna have the floor vote, it's gonna fail, and then we're gonna say mean things about lawmakers on our YouTube shows, I'm sorry, that's not a strategy. It's just not a strategy. People can go ahead and get upset about the truth, but that is the truth. So what is the plan? What are we doing to empower people to organize? What are we doing to encourage people to engage in a general strike? What are we doing to challenge capital? Nothing, nothing. I mean, and what I'm sure that there's some organizing taking place, but it's not something that's being discussed in the context of this debate. And when you have someone who's advocating for this floor vote refer to DSA as, you know, DSA dickheads who aren't doing anything, I think that's a problem. Because the fact of the matter is, I mean, especially in New York, DSA has done some pretty incredible things with local races. And to minimize the organizing that they've been engaged in, I think just shows where, you know, the priorities are for some of the people who are engaging in this debate from a place of bad faith. From a place of narcissism and ego and no, it's my way, and screw all the hard work that everyone else has been doing in trying to get victories on healthcare and a whole host of other issues that, you know, we want victories on. But there are no shortcuts.
My answer. Yeah, and for the purposes of the question about the general strike, I mean, it's just like, yes, in theory, you know, but like the state of the labor movement in the United States is such that, like, you know, if we can get the Amazon factory in Alabama, well, we should like throw a huge party. You know what I mean? Like, it's we're looking for a reversal of trends that have been going on for decades here and that have been continuing. We have not been able to reverse. I mean, we've seen some militancy coming out of the, you know, the teacher strikes, especially in some red states last year. We've seen some militancy coming from the flight attendants union and stuff, and the nurses and things like that. But it's just the seeds of something. It's not it has not translated into a reversal of the very real trends that have been just hammering the labor movement since basically the 1970s. So that, I mean, we just got to stop the bleed. Like, we got to turn it around first and get some concrete victories, get some victories, and then we can start talking about the much bigger things. I find, I don't know, you, Kayla, you know more about this stuff than I do. I mean, the sort of victories that we've seen in New York this week, again, just completely absent the conversation because we're all doing mental masturbation around this
totally, this 100%.
This debate.
Right.
I kind of regret not doing my decode on that, because I think that would have fit nicely with the, you know, the discussion that we just had with David. But now's a good time maybe to, you know, mention it.
Yeah, Kel, tell him what happened.
Oh, you're talking about service sector workers.
Yes.
Well, there's two things happening in New York right now. Part of it is people are asking me to mention organizations that are in the M4A coalition. Sorry, I'm getting distracted, but the M4A Coalition, Healthcare Now, PNHP, NNU, DSA, I think I missed earlier the Labor Campaign for Single Payer, What Mark Dudzik and others have done in that organization is phenomenal. And like, if I, you know, I would just say like, that's where the action is right now. That like, it's the not sexy, it's the really hard down and dirty work of trying to get unions on board and union organizers on board with single payer. And you know, my hat's off a million times over to Mark Dudzik. But in New York, there's a couple things happening. On the healthcare front, there are nurses that do not have the right amount of equipment and PPE and resources they need to actually carry out their job. And so they have been basically striking throughout New York saying, we need those resources and we cannot properly do our job without them. Again, this is how you get the goods. It's like, these are, when you're dealing with, whether it's for-profit institutions or whether you're dealing with public sector institutions, you have to stop one of two things. You have to stop the flow of profits, or you have to stop other people's ability to continue making profits. So kind of a general public disturbance. And that's, you know, in, I'm trying to remember his name. There's a great old Marxist who would say that vulgar Marxism explains like 90% of everything.
It's 100%.
It's like, this is not like a blanket, it covers every single instance, but like most of the time, we just talked about this yesterday with Harvey K. Like, it comes down to labor struggles. It comes down to like, because capitalism is built on profits, accumulating profits, like you have to hit them at the point of making those profits, and working people are the people who are in that position to do that. So the thing about
boring and repetitive to make that point over and over again, but it's just so easy to get because it's the hardest thing to do. It becomes easy to get distracted and try other things, right? But all the other stuff doesn't work without it. I mean, all that stuff is on top of that, you know. And you know, it's funny, like, to think back on the civil rights movement. And the things that get remembered are things outside of that particular realm, mm-hmm. right? But it really, the things that we remember were just kind of like the sprinkling on top of pretty militant labor struggles at threatening profits and capital.
We forget that like the people who organized the civil rights movement, which took decades, were labor leaders. this was an extension of the labor movement to an extent. Obviously, it's something distinct, and that's why we call it the civil rights movement.
And the sort of problematic, stodgy labor unions of the time, the sort of corrupt mafia, you've seen the Irishman, blah, 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 all those people, all of those labor unions supported civil rights in those days, like all of them. So,
yeah. Well, having a union has been the greatest anti-racist institution we've ever had. It's the thing that actually breaks down racial animosity and discriminatory attitudes among people, and ultimately actually deals with racial oppression in a real material substantive way. Because racial oppression can only exist if there are economic inequalities. Otherwise, why is there oppression going on? If the person being oppressed has an exit option or can actually fight back, then it's not really oppression, it's a fight. But if it's oppression, like, there's inequality of material income or material resources. And so unions are the means of actually creating a much better life with much better allocation of resources, much higher living standards for most working people. The thing in New York this week is that the city council just voted that service sector workers that are not in unions cannot be arbitrarily fired, which is the first time in this country's history, I'm pretty sure it's the first in the nation right now, where basically if you are a union member, you most likely, there might be some cases where this isn't true, but most likely you cannot be arbitrarily fired.
Yeah,
because that's part of the conditions of having the union, is that it has some floor of protection. For most workers, they don't show up one day, or they screw up one thing or whatever. They could be fired whenever if the boss just thinks, you're not working hard enough.
They don't like the way they don't like the way they smile or something. Yeah, right. And it's like, the guy's got a weird smile, and fire him. Yeah,
exactly. So service sector workers cannot be arbitrarily. Well, I don't know exactly when it takes effect. I should probably know this, but But it will be the case that service sector workers cannot be arbitrarily fired. This is massive.
A massive victory. Important. Massive both, victory.
Both yeah. for the unorganized workers in New York City, but also yeah. the organized workers in New York City, because this makes their job a lot easier as well. That, yeah. You know, in the process of organizing new locations, you know, the bargaining committee can't just be kicked out automatically as soon as activity starts. So this is massive. This is really important. And we'll keep covering, I'm sure we'll keep talking about this in the future as well.
Yeah.
I wanted to say also that, like, we, you know, this whole, let's just kind of pressure a politician to doing the right thing. We've done this a million times, and it's dressed up in different language. There's more liberal versions of it. There's more radical versions of it. But it has severe limitations. I'm not saying, like, it's not, like, super, super strict that, like, this doesn't ever work. But especially when it comes to, like, massive questions of budgets and of, like, industries that are making tons and tons of profit, like, this is not going to be a, let's just convince some hearts and minds on this. Let's just tell someone who campaigned on one thing that, you know, you have to do this thing and jeopardize everything else. Like, even
Kale, if the, you know, so, have you, you know that famous scene in Sorry to Bother You, I mean Sorry to Bother yes. You, like, this was what the whole movie is about. He uncovers the bad thing that the company did, and his solution at first is to go on, like, all the talk shows, all the late night talk shows, and go call your congressman. This is a version of call your congressman,
right?
And everyone does it, and then nothing happens, right? And then it wasn't until he realized that he needed to participate and help the labor struggle that he had previously shunned in the movie that he was able to that anything was able to happen. Right. And that's just what that's what the movie was about. Like, and it's, you know, that's just the only way to do it. I mean, the sort of this is a version of call your congressman.
Yeah,
that's it.
There is no substitute for actual organizing. And we saw that in Iowa this year, that, like, the yeah. Democratic Party tried to do every single thing they could to destroy Bernie's campaign in Iowa. They tried to torpedo us so freaking bad. And they like stole the election results on the night of and had fucking Rat Pete
Buttigieg.
Fucking yeah, Buttigieg. Yeah. Announced on the night of, like, oh yeah, I won. Like, even though we were up all night into, like, up until like 3 and 4 in the morning counting calling a precinct captain saying, what were the numbers in your precinct? Oh, it looks like Bernie's winning, actually, from our internal data that we knew to fucking organize around because we knew they were going to fuck us over. Like, I'm using we kind of generously. I was a volunteer. But, like, it is not going to be through social media. You cannot organize political campaigns through social media. Like, you can get some signatures on, like, a change.org or whatever. I remember a million of those during the Obama era, and that really worked. But there is no substitute for actual political campaigns and political organizing, and especially labor organizing. Like, this is the lifeblood of left politics. This is, like, you just have to look at the actual history. Like, the problem is that we haven't had a left, and we haven't had a strong, healthy, militant labor movement in 40, 50, 60 years. So, like, we look to ideas in the last couple decades, and they're all losers. Like, yeah. Like, losers. I'm sorry.
Bye. Bye-bye. You're losers. You're very loser. Loser ideas.
This is, you know, I mean, I'm being a little superfluous hyperbolic. That's the word I wanted. We're being a little hyperbolic, right? I'm being hyperbolic right now. But the point is that, like, look to when the left actually won things. Look to, if you want to actually learn about the civil rights movement, you actually have to learn that there was deep connections to the labor movement that, like, it wasn't, you know, MLK changing hearts and minds, you know, and convincing people that racism is bad. Like, you look to the labor movement of the 30s, like, you look to, like, the New Deal legislation that didn't come out of FDR's head. Like, you know, if all it took was just a good idea, like, the left would have won, like, over a century ago. Like, we've won the ideas over and over again. Like, you know, we win some fights or we win the ideas sometimes, then we recede and we come back and we have to start over again, because these things are ephemeral. Like, political organizing, labor organizing cannot be substituted.
All right. I think that's a good place to leave it. I'm honestly like, I'm ready to go. I'm ready to rest a little bit and not think about this debate that's been going on forever. I think everything you said is absolutely right. All I can think about is the reactions to the very common sense argument that you're making, Kale. Because yeah, I think people's anger and rage is being exploited right now to a point where they're being convinced that there are easy answers and there is a shortcut. And there just isn't. And so I don't know. We'll see how this all plays out. But thank you to our audience. We are going to take a break next week for the holidays. But we'll be back in the new year, as Kale mentioned, with new episodes of Weekends. And that's all I have to say. Any final words, guys?
I'm going to miss you guys. I'm going to miss our talks, our time together. It's always a lot of fun. I always learn a lot. It's just going to be, I can't believe it's going to be all the way till next year. We're not going to see each other. It's very sad.
I mean, we can still do this next week. We just won't record it. You guys won't.
Right. We'll just do it a private session. Yeah.
I like that idea a lot. Anyway, guys, thank you for, go ahead, Kale.
I was just gonna say happy holidays. Thank you so much to our audience. That this has been the most fun I've ever had working on anything ever. That it's been an utmost pleasure and privilege and honor to be working with you, Anna, and with you, Nando, and with the late, great Michael Brooks. The show has meant so much to me, and I'm glad to be on it and hope to keep working on it next year. So.
Kale, you're going to make me cry, dude. What the hell?
I know, seriously.
Sorry, Kale,
stop it.
Yeah, no, it really is a pleasure working with you guys. And, I love the format of this show. I love the deep dives. I love thinking critically about these things in a nuanced way. And, gotta give a shout out to Bhaskar and Jacobin overall for providing a space to have these conversations. They're really, really important. And hopefully this show and others on the Jacobin channel continue to grow in the new year. So thank you everyone for watching. I hope you have happy holidays and we'll see you next year.
Bye.
Bye-bye.